or have just come. So we are going to round two of this symposium, panel two, and I will introduce the moderator of that panel, Colin Westerbeck. Colin Westerbeck is an independent writer, critic, and curator who has been based in Los Angeles since 2003. He wrote a weekly column on photography for the Los Angeles Times and taught the history of photography at UCLA and USC. From 2008 through 2011, Westerbeck was the director of the California Museum of Photography at the University of California, Riverside, where he curated such exhibitions as Seismic Shift, Louis Baltz, Joe Dio, and California Landscape Photography, 1944 to 1984. Before moving to Los Angeles, he was a curator of photography at the Art Institute of Chicago from 1986 through 2003. Among the exhibitions he curated there were On the Art of Fixing a Shadow in 1989, What's New Prague, 1992, The James Vanderzee Studio, 2004, and Irving Penn, A Career in Photography, 1997, which celebrated the donation that Westerbeck had brought to the Museum of Penn's Archives and Photography. Westerbeck is also a very accomplished author. With photographer Joel Meyerowitz, he published the book Bystander, A History of Street Photography, which will have a new 20th anniversary edition at the end of this year. This fall, Prestel will publish Westerbeck's monograph, Chuck Close Photographer, and in the spring 2015, his exhibition of Close's photography will open at the Parrish Museum in Long Island. Westerbeck also writes about photography for Art in America and contributes essays to many exhibition catalogs. Please join me in welcoming Colin Westerbeck in panel two.
Good afternoon. It's great to see such a wonderful turnout today. And I'm going to do an introduction to the panel from here. And I want to try and keep it down to 15 minutes or maybe a little bit more, and then so we can sit down and have plenty of time for our discussion afterwards. The panel is seated, Matthew at that end, Stephen Shore at this end. I'm going to talk about them in alphabetical order. Matthew Brandt grew up in the world of LA photography. His father was a commercial photographer here with a very successful career and a studio in Hollywood in what had been a Technicolor factory. That facility of his father's, Matthew has now inherited as his own studio, and he himself is already launched at age 32 on a very successful career of his own. Although Matthew spent a two-year apprenticeship as an assistant to Robert Polidori, a photographer whose career spans the worlds of art and commerce, Matthew's own focus has been on art photography from very early on. His path departed from his father's when he not only left LA for New York, but did so in order to study painting at Cooper Union, where he was again drawn back to photography because it had come to seem a medium in which the aesthetic questions that painting raised could now be addressed just as well, if not better. The apprenticeship with Polidori followed Matthew's graduation from Cooper Union, and after that, he headed back to LA and into the MFA program in photography that Jim Welling was running at UCLA. The experimental atmosphere that Matthew found at UCLA appealed to him because it was, he has said, quote, messy and free, which are terms he also applied approvingly to the Technicolor factory in both his father's tenure there and his own. It was in Matthew's last year in the MFA program in 2008 that I first met him. When he took a graduate seminar, Jim Welling had asked me to teach there. As I told Jim at the time, Matthew struck me as a kind of a cross between Bruce Nauman and Vic Muniz. He still reminds me of those two predecessors in certain ways, though his work and his career since then have taken on a personality uniquely their own. In the last few years, he has been represented by M&B Gallery in New York, or M&B Gallery here, and in New York by Yossi Milo, one of the hippest and most idiosyncratic of the New York dealers. Last year, Matthew also received his first career survey exhibition at the Columbus Museum of Art in Columbus, Ohio. I want to give people time to look at the slides of the individuals on the panel today, because it's their work, after all, that we're going to discuss now. And I want you to have a moment to really fix in mind what the range of material is. In Matthew's work especially, I hope you've been reading the process titles. John Divola is a quintessentially SoCal photographer, as quintessentially one as you're ever going to see. Among the places he grew up was Calabasas, from which he had migrated into UCLA for his MFA under Robert Heineken, after which, in 1989, he moved out again to teach at UC Riverside, where he has been ever since. From there, his photography has gone further out into the desert. Having started on the western edge of the LA region, he has explored it all the way to its eastern boundary. His photographic career gets its real continuity, though, from the sensibility with which he has explored this landscape. As a teenager, he'd sneak into the derelict Fox Movie Ranch in Calabasas. As a photographer in LA, he's repeatedly gone on location to scenes of dislocation. The year he earned his MFA, he did the vandalism series in abandoned houses where he could spray paint silver graffiti that was beautiful in silver gelatin prints. His next series, LAXNAZ, was in houses that had been condemned to create a noise abatement zone around Los Angeles County Airport. And in the Zuma series, which was made in a house on Zuma Beach, it had the dual advantage of having a picture window overlooking the ocean and being the property of the fire department there, which practiced burning the place down. Divola went to color film to make the most not only of the beauty of the sunsets, but of the horror of the charred interior covered with his graffiti. The progression from Zuma to isolated houses in the desert, where he found more extreme examples like houses built off the grid, then abandoned, is a seamless one. Out there, a vicious dog chasing his car was often the only sign of life. Divola finds in such places a certain pathos, the arid melancholy of broken dreams, and he feels, that he feels is inherent in photography itself as a medium. In desert houses now deserted, where paintings were left unfinished like the house itself, the camera is the right instrument to capture the sadness of unfulfilled hopes. This kind of seeing takes its toll. No wonder that, in the vastness of the gigapan's view, he runs away from the camera into the vastness of the wilderness as fast as he can. When Harry Gamboa Jr. was 5, he was given a test in which he had to pick out the correct drawing of a chick from 5 illustrations. All but one was, he's explained, missing a wing, a leg, or a beak. Instead of choosing the one whole bird, he drew in the missing appendages on the others. This was a premonition, perhaps, of his lifelong dedication to inclusion rather than exclusion, and to collaboration as a way for Chicanos to address their marginalized state. This was the spirit in which Harry founded his performance troupe, OSCO, in 1972. OSCO performances like Decoy Gang War Victim and First Supper After a Major Riot, both 1974, were what might be called planned improvisations. planned in the sense that they were sometimes scripted costume dramas, but improvisational because their theater was the streets. At Garfield High School, Harry had organized demonstrations called blowouts, protesting conditions at inner city schools. This got him photographed with Bobby Kennedy and photographed by the LAPD. Consequently, Harry says, quote, "It kind of clicked that they had pictures and I didn't have pictures to prove my point," close quote. So as UCLA professor Chani Noriega put it, Gamboa bought a camera and headed back to the streets. The result, and a primary reason Harry is here today, was that he documented the performance pieces, interventions, manifestations, and whatever other mischief Osco and a later troupe he founded called Virtual Verite got up to. When LACMA rejected Osco's 1972 demand to exhibit Chicano art, Harry and friends graffitied their signatures all on the walls at LACMA, thereby claiming it as their work of art. In 1974, two members taped themselves to another wall near the museum's entrance. Indeed, walls have become not just a setting for street theater, but rather an actor in the drama itself, from the 1972 Osco piece, Walking Mural, in which, as Noriega said, the tortured mural faces walk off the wall and into the streets, to a 2014 Virtual Verite video, Exist, Resist, in which people feel their way along a wall, almost caressing it beside a heavily traveled road. In the 1970s, Harry was driving a bus to fund Osco, and after the group disbanded in 1985, it was two decades before he founded the new group, Virtual Verite, which has been going strong ever since. Alex Prager was born in LA in 1979 in, according to one of the many articles about her, the back room of her grandmother's Los Feliz apartment. It was seeing an exhibition of William Eggleston's photography that got her hooked on the medium, so much so that she went right to work, skipping not only going to art school, but finishing high school. In my experience, the sort of highly directorial work she does, work whose staging is more like the shooting of a feature film than the type of private, singular, solitary, candid activity that we usually associate with art photography, that it takes someone who's very smart in a completely unpretentious, unassuming way to do it. Having spent time as a curator working first with Irving Penn in the 1990s and more recently with Chuck Close, I've come to believe that a photographer needs an exceptional kind of personality to manage a complex commercial career while making no distinction between that and what we usually call the personal work of the art photographer. Accomplishment on that level takes someone who is paradoxically modest and free of the sort of ego that can cloud judgment and spoil results under such complicated working conditions. Whatever it takes, Alex clearly has had the intuitive intelligence to build that type of career without having needed anyone to teach her how to do it. Alex's work is particularly relevant to our purposes here today because its manipulation of a look we associate with Hollywood movies makes it a very LA in nature. That this connection is obvious doesn't make her work any less arresting, however. Another influence she has acknowledged, besides Eggleston, is Cindy Sherman. If ambiguity is the soul of art, as I believe it is, her work, like Sherman's, has plenty to offer us and the sort of depth necessary to keep the viewer's imagination engaged. The one distraction from her talents as a photographer that both she and we have to worry about is her increasing commitment to actually making short movies rather than parroting their style and still photographs. Borrowing Orson Welles' title, Touch of Evil, she made a series of costume movie vignettes commissioned by the New York Times that starred Brad Pitt, Glenn Close, and George Clooney, among other Hollywood luminaries, and that won her an Emmy Award for Direction in 2012. Having been yet another prodigy, one even more precocious than Alex, Stephen Shore was given his first darkroom kit at age 6. By age 9, according to Wikipedia, he began using a 35 millimeter camera and shooting color. A year later, he got another prize present, a copy of Walker Evans' American Photographs. And 4 years after that, when he was still only 14, he submitted some prints to Edward Steichen, the curator of photography at the Museum of Modern Art. And Steichen bought 3 of the prints for the MoMA collection. Although Shore also hung out at the factory when he was 17, photographing Warhol and his entourage, the promise that he had shown while growing up in New York didn't truly come to fruition until after he left town in 1972-73 to go photograph the rest of America on an odyssey that took him from New York to LA and back again. Well, I believe that he saw his work as something following naturally from that of Walker Evans and Robert Frank. Doing so in color, indeed in prints processed by Kodak in its New Jersey lab, bamboozled critics and some curators. Reviews of a show of that work at New York's Light Gallery reflected a great deal of skepticism. The key exception to the criticisms was the response of the curator at the Metropolitan Museum, Weston Neff, who was, of course, later to be the founding curator of the Department of Photographs here at the Getty. Weston acquired the entire body of work for the Met's collection. This dramatic but ultimately auspicious beginning of Stephen's career has been followed now by many decades during which the importance of that seminal body of work has been repeatedly corroborated by, in addition to a teaching career of over 30 years at Bard College, new photography of equal seriousness, as well as international recognition of Stephen's achievement. From the mid-1970s, when Stephen was the only color photographer to be included in the new topographics exhibition that altered the very idea of landscape, to the Dusseldorf School and the Beschers, who revered Shore's work as they did almost no other American photographers, his reputation has only grown. The new work that he has done in LA in recent years both extends his earlier vision of the city and alters it in subtle ways. So this panel, I think, is a really interesting one for a number of reasons. And one is that, as you'll notice from the slides that you've just seen, 3 members of the panel have careers that go well back before 1989. This is the 175th anniversary is really what we're celebrating here. But they have careers that go back to before the 150th anniversary. And 2 of the photographers have careers that only have begun very recently. So I thought, to start with, I would ask John and Harry and Stephen if they could talk a little bit about how they feel their photography has changed, or whether it has changed over the years, or whether it's a continuous kind of process that hasn't undergone basic alteration. Anybody want to start with that, Harry?
Yeah, sure. Well, in one way, the people that were young and beautiful in 1972 are still beautiful, but no longer young. I think one of the things has been, I find that Los Angeles, to some degree, has this constant sense of urgency based on a facade of tranquility. And tectonic plates shift to such a degree that you go out and take photographs, and every day is a completely new day because of the structure itself. And so I can return to places where I've taken photographs, and it's always a different place. Mm. And so in a way, creates sort of this sensibility that there is momentum, but one never knows if it's in forward or backwards in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm. Has it affected the way you approach the whole question of doing performance pieces and documenting them?
Oh, yes. I've had three different groups. The first one's very well known. The second one probably is still serving time. And the third group of Virtual Verite is a highly educated, very excellent group of young people that are very gifted and driven. And I find this particular group to probably be, will prove to be important in the end, because the kinds of works that we undertake are usually operatic in a sense, utilizing the streets as to create moments that could have existed but haven't quite yet.
Okay. Stephen, what about your work?
I realized fairly early on that I didn't have a taste for repeating myself. And that whenever I found myself essentially copying myself, I needed to do something different. Mm-hmm. And that could be different content. It could be a different format. I will gladly avail myself of new technology, sometimes old technology. In 1991, I realized I'd been doing color for exactly 20 years exclusively, and decided that for the next decade I was going to work just in black and white. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it's not going forward, it's going back. Mm-hmm. But I'm also very interested in new technology. In the early 2000s, for 5 years, I was using print-on-demand technology to do a series of books, and that was my main work. Mm-hmm. And so I'll draw from either content or from technique to keep things interesting. I mean, I like solving photographic problems, and the problems can come from lots of different places.
Do you find, I know we were talking a little earlier today about the work you've done in Israel recently, when you go to a society that is as different in both geographical infrastructure and ultimately cultural structure from as different from America, does that change the way you work, or do you find that that somehow the subject adapts to the method? Mm-hmm.
I don't find it changes it, because when I was taking my trips across America in the 70s, it was a foreign country to me. Uh-huh. I mean, I knew the coasts. Yeah. And the middle of the country was foreign. In fact, I felt myself an explorer. And on one of the trips, went to Abercrombie and Fitch, which in those days, before it was a modern clothing store, was a safari outfitter. Mm-hmm. And got a proper safari outfit to drive across the country. Mm-hmm. And what I was interested in was coming to a place and both with fresh eyes, but with to see what was essential to that place. Mm-hmm. And I think it's really the same as what I've been doing in Israel and the West Bank. But there's an added element, which is that there is a more dramatic political situation, which then fits into the equation of what I photograph.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What about you?
Well, as a photographer, the subject changes, right? I work primarily in Southern California, and it's certainly evolved and physically changed the kinds of spaces I photograph and change. I like to think that I change at least to some degree incrementally over time. So my point of perspective changes and the technology changes. So I hope that I've evolved and changed over time, and it's relative to those elements.
That's a very good point, is that we're not static beings. and we hope we learn things as we get older.
Does the difference between the work like the Zuma work in color and working in black and white, is that a completely different situation for you? Or are the rules always the same? The rules of the way you approach it?
To me, it's all about process and it being open to discoveries and observations relative to the process. We had I was on the panel, those of you that are probably sick of me, I was on the panel this morning talking about education. And we actually didn't teach very much, we didn't talk very much about actually literally teaching.
Mm-hmm.
But actually when I teach, I tell people, I don't want to know what your work's going to be about. I don't want to know what it's going to look like. I don't want to know what it's going to mean. I mm-hmm. want to know the process. I want to know literally mm-hmm. how you're going to go about it.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, it's about sort of identifying a process, a way of working. It might be going somewhere, it might be using certain kinds of materials. And then I get that ball rolling and I try to make observations as that thing unfolds. And that that approach doesn't change. Mm-hmm. That approach is the same. But the venue can change, the materials can change, mm-hmm. the technology can change.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Okay. What about Alex and Matthew? You don't have a career of that length at this point. How do you look at their work? What is it in the kind of
watch
pictures
what you
that
say.
I'm
sure?
Way to put us on the spot.
How is it, when you look at one of the things that I liked about the setup of this is that each of the three photographers who had a history that went back further than 1989 sent me some examples of their earlier work. So you've seen that going on here. How do you relate to that, that kind of career and perhaps your own aspirations for your future, but also the way you look at the work of a photographer who's been working longer than you? One of you wanna?
I mean, I really like what was said earlier about staying interested in what you're doing. Clearly these guys have a strong interest in what they're doing, and I think that's probably the key thing, and that alone is inspiring. I love each panelist's work that's been up here,
mm-hmm.
but for very different reasons, that's very different work, so it's kind of hard to generalize a one mm-hmm. statement to blanket all of them,
mm-hmm.
but it's inspiring to see people that have been shooting for that long because they've stayed interested somehow. And I feel like that's gonna be an interesting challenge.
Mm-hmm.
Is it something you think about?
No, not right now. But I feel like, I'm so interested in what I'm doing right now that I don't really think too far ahead, but 5, 10, 15, 30 years from now, it'll be interesting to see how, what happens with the technology and newer kids coming along and
mm-hmm.
seeing, how to keep myself interested and challenged,
mm-hmm.
not get stuck in a rut.
To what extent have either of you worked? I mean, obviously, Matthew, you work a great deal with wet process of a lot of different kinds, but to a very large extent. Alex, you've worked with really digital technologies and in the interface between filmmaking and still photography.
I still shoot film.
No, you do.
Yeah,
yeah. You shoot film and scan it, mm-hmm. scan negative.
Yeah.
Yes, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Try and get the best of both worlds.
Uh huh. Why? Why do you prefer to work in that way instead of going directly to digital or something like that or other options?
Well, I found that with film, the grain alone. Is enough of a reason for me to stick with it as long as it still exists. The quality of getting that certain aesthetic, mm-hmm. the color, the texture, there's something that's very unflat about film when I look at it, mm-hmm. when I see the images blown up really big. If it's smaller, for me, I don't really notice that much of a difference. And if I'm shooting editorial or something commercially, they want me to shoot digital, and that's fine. Mm-hmm. But when they're being blown up 5 by 8 feet, I can really feel the difference, and it's important to have that beginning and then scan it in and work with the mm-hmm. new technology.
A lot of the work that you've done, I'm thinking especially polyester, some a project like that, you know, has a not too explicit, but a definitely implicit retro look to it. Is it that film enhances that and makes it more ambiguous as to whether it's the present or the past in some way?
Absolutely. I mean, it's really important for me to keep the time period sort of. You can't ever really put a finger on what time period is. Also, I find a lot of people that shoot digital want to add grain afterwards. Mm-hmm. And so my question is, why don't they just shoot film? Because the grain is already there. And, and it's the real thing. So people still want that look. For my images in particular, that's a whole other subject of why I need that timeless feel. That's pulling from, you know, something that Hollywood has used mm-hmm. in movies to pull from the familiar. It's something that's kind of nostalgic about it, so it kind of lures people in, or maybe makes them feel like the image is safe in a certain way, mm-hmm. and when in fact there's something else a little darker going on underneath the surface. So the grain really helps with the aesthetic that I'm working
mm-hmm.
with.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Matthew? You've sort of invented a technology all your own, in a certain sense. But again, you're born into the digital age. Did you work a lot in wet darkroom when you were a student, and before you got into the series, the kind of series you're doing now, or not?
Yeah, I guess. I'm sorry, I'm a little nervous, guys. Just to let you know. And it's not necessarily this whole field of people. I think it's also being in such a great company. Almost feel like I should be sitting on the ground or something like that. but that's just my disclosure to let you guys know for any sort of poor responses. But I feel like I've always sort of learned about film from a wet chemistry background. I guess there was, at my high school, not too far from here, there was a photography department there, black and white chemistry. And also just working with my dad in the studio, I think I was an assistant since I was like 9 years old, I think, mm-hmm. and just sort of almost grew into the process. And I always looked at photography in a way as a kind of a trade, and was always doing drawings and thought that I was I didn't take photography seriously as an art until I think much later.
Mm.
But it was still fun to play around, and to me it was just sort of a utilitarian tool, you know,
mm.
I guess learning about the wetness in this. But then I think later, and I did horrible in chemistry, so I didn't really appreciate photography for what it was until much later. You know, actually, I think honestly, until like moving back to Los Angeles, I think until I really started to get nasty and dirty with the photography.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What do, again, either of you, Alex or Matthew, have a kind of projection to your career? Again, we've looked at three careers that have legs over the past. You're looking out to what projects you might take on in the future. Do you see your careers as, you think that the ideas you're working with now are going to last you throughout your career, or are you projecting, taking on other subjects, other ways of working? The interface, I think, in your case, Alex, between video or filmmaking and photography is, as I suggested when I was introducing your career, you know, is a real issue for you at this point. And I know you've talked a bit about wanting to stick with photography despite, you know, what I was suggesting. So is that part of your thinking about where you're going to land?
I mean, from the beginning, the direction that I've gone in has always been very impulsive and intuitive.
Mm-hmm.
So there hasn't really been much analytical thinking behind it, with planning or... I never thought I would be making films. If you would have told me 8 years ago that I was going to be doing half film, half photography, I'd, I wouldn't have believed it because it was just not on my radar. Same as photography wasn't on my radar until I came to the Getty Center and saw the William Eggleston exhibition. Mm. And the same week after seeing that, being introduced to color photography, I bought a camera and darkroom equipment on eBay. Like, it's all been very kind of unplanned. So who knows what new technology is going to come out in 10 years from now and make me want to try something else.
Okay.
But I definitely don't think one idea is going to last my whole career now.
Okay. You know, Harry, in your situation, from the beginning were you shooting either, you know, high eight or some kind of, making some kind of video or film documentary along with shooting still photographs? And conversely, now do you still shoot still photographs or are the pieces video pieces?
Well, I guess in the 70s I was shooting Super 8, the film. And then in the 80s I got introduced to something known as public access, which was privately owned cable companies. Southern California, there was one company that was hooked up to 1.5 million homes. They had a what was known as public access channel, and I was making a video a week that would plug it in and show it to 1.5 million homes. All of my productions cost about $25, and some of them exist today. There's one that's still online from Mocha called Baby Cake. I was doing sort of these very short pieces that would satirize domestic life. And in the end, there were many complaints from 500,000 homes that I was destroying lives. And so they were all taken down and summarily destroyed, but some, very few survived. And now I use just a point and shoot Lumix and create these short videos that I'm able to generate. I produce my own audio and so introduce people to just vignettes that connect to whatever's going on in terms of my daily life, but also as a commentary and sometimes as a supplement to some of the other performance works. So there's it's always kind of interactive in some level, and so there was a series I was doing called Worker Ant, which I'd taken on the role of someone that's trudging back and forth to work, which is what I do. Of course, I teach at universities, but it's the process between here and there that's repetitive, and I get to see how other people are living because I utilize public transportation, and so there's a great pathos that's developed from me trying to get to CalArts. And then CalArts is a good experience, but on the way back and forth, it's kind of this Sisyphus effect, you know. So it's really quite great. So.
It's interesting. I was talking before with Robert, and Robert Flick also uses a Lumix when he shoots the freeway, sometimes doing this little short burst video thing. And then, you know, the whole distinction between the digital age has certainly broken down the distinction between the still and the moving image in a way that wasn't true until fairly recently.
Well, and part of it, again, this is like LA shoots itself. One of the things in LA is you don't want to get shot anyway. So it's like, that accounts for the low profile camera, which, you know, people aren't really sure what you're doing, if you're doing a selfie or, you know, doing something else, so.
Okay. your career is the one that seems to me to have the most consistent continuity, again, perhaps because I've been thinking about it a lot lately, and that for that piece that I wrote, and which I sort of condensed here today. What is affecting you now that didn't affect you, you know, 20 years ago?
I've never been accused of continuity before.
Really?
What is affecting me now? I don't know that any of the, when you ask people what are they going to do in the future, you know, I work in a medium where the operative action takes a fraction of a second. Mm-hmm. So there's almost no excuse for me not to try anything that pops into my head. And so I tend to do that. So I likewise don't have much projection into the future unless it involves a lot of planning and getting together materials or money or something of that line. There are just practical limitations that affect me. It's like I've been using a technology called a gigapan, which was kind of developed for the Mars rover. It kind of incrementally scans the scene and you seam all the images together into this giant megapixel image. And I love doing it, but then, you know, I end up with these gigantic prints that I can't afford to frame or move around. So those are the kinds of like stupid limitations that bother me. And there's nothing in terms of context or content really that affects me other than that.
Mm-hmm. What about, to what extent, this is a question that I know Alex is interested in, to what extent do you think about your audience, or to put it more crudely, even a market when you make photographs? Any of you? Do you?
I don't think about it.
At all?
I don't ever think about the market. I think of the audience as a fictional, I think of making art as definitely a form of communication. And I obviously think that anything I make needs to be read by somebody that doesn't have my consciousness or subjectivity. But it doesn't matter if they don't exist in the present.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm willing to assume them in some sense. So I don't think of a specific audience. I'm the primary audience.
Okay.
And I was raised pretty much in the Cold War,
mm-hmm.
and I became an astute observer of propaganda. I was on the receiving end and learned very much how to turn it the other way. And so in a way, it's very interesting to view large populations as potential viewers,
mm-hmm.
And understand that people interpret individually, but at the same time, arrive sometimes at conclusions that could be shared amongst other people. So it's important to create work that might generate a little bit of interest, but at the same time, I'm also from the Marshall McLuhan age, so it's part of it is also the message that I'm kind of interested in. So it's sometimes it's the message that's excluded or creates the lie of omission because it's not there. And so I put it there.
So the work that Osco did, certainly in that era, there were, as it were, two audiences and two possible reactions. One audience that would cheer,
right,
and another audience that would feel uneasy, that would feel confronted or so forth. Were you equally interested in both audiences, or were you playing just to one and the other was their problem?
Well, you know, the thing is that the Osco period was also the Vietnam era, and at that point, all of my very good friends were probably in the process of dying, and it was a kind of very intense kind of moment in the sense that the idea was for many of ideas that were being shared by many people at that time, but in a way that could persist over time,
mm-hmm.
which was the important understanding that I had, was to create work that could outlive even the members of Osco.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. But Stephen, what about you and the question of audience? I mean, you had an audience that much of which was not very appreciative, at least right at first, and then mm-hmm. since then, of course, you've gained the status that you deserve. But, you know, did you feel at the time when you first put that work out there and it caused controversy, this is great, you know, people are paying attention whether they like it or not, or were you,
no,
how did you feel about it?
My answer is the same as John's.
John's, you do
that,
it for yourself.
Obviously, one is aware that the work is going to go out,
mm-hmm.
but it's just personal. It's just, I have these questions in my mind that I have to figure out, and that's what's driving it, and sometimes people like it and sometimes they don't. It wasn't all bad in the 70s.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. No, I mean, I know.
I would also get good reviews too.
Yeah.
The show you were referring to, American Services, did, however, get trashed. But because I wasn't really doing it for the audience, I just plowed ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So I think John really summed it up very well.
Okay. That is perhaps partly a generational difference that again, photography didn't have a recognizable audience of a certain size.
That's true. That's the other part of it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit going back to the discussion we had this morning. If you weren't going to do it for yourself, then who the hell were you going to do it for?
Yeah.
What about you?
Being a famous photographer in 1970 meant that a couple of hundred people on the face of the planet would recognize
right,
your name.
Right, right. They'd seen some of your pictures. Right, exactly. What about you, Matthew? Are you, you know, you've had a considerable success and attracted a lot of attention, especially with the Lake series. Do you think about audience, about who you might reach with this kind of work, or would you say like John, well, I do it for myself, and the rest of it's, you know, somebody else's problem?
Well, I think that if you're making works with cocaine, selling it to people, I think there's some sort of interesting sales dynamic, and that was some of the reasoning for sort of making the work was like, can I really pull this off? And so, you know, in a way, I'm surprised that like I can, you know, legally sell those works.
Elaborate a little bit. Did you really, you know, go and see if you were going to get in trouble with the law?
Well, there was actually, M&B was really great. We consulted a lawyer and then thought about the logistics. And I mean, at the end of the day, it probably all boils down on me and it's probably really bad, but it seems like it's good and it's working. And I think that it's an interesting dynamic, you know? But I don't necessarily, I'm not trying to be like a pusher, cocaine pusher, or anything like that. But I think it's an interesting dynamic for selling art and then drugs, and that how do you determine value? And you know, they both have kind of similar value, you know, market-wise. You know, and I kind of just, you know, there was an interesting part for me. So I feel like that work doesn't really exist without sort of the sales part of it, I guess, in a way. But that's just the very tail end of it, you know. But I didn't make it just to sell it. It was really about how particles land on velvet and how it looks, and I'm really, you know, very much invested in the process, and I feel like that's just a major driving factor, and I just have to co-sign to John's explanation to just, it's about the process, and it's about learning something new, and that's sort of the main driving force, because I don't want to be like a printer, I mean, you know, an Epson printer and just like making stuff all the time, because then you know, I feel like it would bore everybody, you know?
Well, you've made, with the cocaine piece, you made a piece that was controversial and seemed to have these two edges to it. With the lake pieces, you know, it's perhaps an ecological, you know, I mean, it doesn't have the inherent controversy that using cocaine or some other substances that you've used. You know, is one better than the other? Is one kind of subject that has an edginess or an ambivalence that it might create more satisfying or less satisfying, or does it not really matter?
I mean, it doesn't really matter. I just feel like the two very different projects that have different characteristics, if that makes sense. I feel like the lakes are more well-known because they're maybe, you know, they're picturesque. I go to a lake, I take a nice photograph, and then they become sort of colorful things. And I think also, they're sort of easier to make, too. It's easier to get lake water than it is to get cocaine, you know? So there's obviously more work.
That's surprising, you know. Actually.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But so I don't know if I answered any questions, I guess each project is a little different in terms of how, you know, how it's made or received or whatever.
Okay. And Alex, what about you? I mean, again, you're, at least the way that I talked about your career, I really called attention to the fact that you work for two audiences, and one of them is commerce. That is to say, you're commissioned to do pieces of a certain kind for publication by magazines, and yet you also reach an art audience and have aspirations in that regard, both where a publication and where the prints are concerned. You know, do you put on two different hats? Do you think in two different ways when you're doing bodies of work, or is it all just one thing and, you know, whatever the project is?
Yeah, it's really, I don't really take commercial work unless I can get into it the same way that I approach art projects. So it's actually not that often that I'm commissioned by brands or magazines to take work, because I think usually people have their own idea and then they want to have the photographer shoot their idea. And it's just not it's not what I'm trying to do. So, but to answer your audience question, for me, it's really important what the audience, how the audience responds, that my work connects somewhere, because it's, I mean, of course, the process is important for me in trying to answer my own questions and solve my own problems through the work. But I feel like that's only half of it. And then to know that, because it's such an emotional kind of process for me, or psychological sort of look for me, that to know that it's connecting somewhere is really important. And from that, I've gotten some good ideas. Like, to do my first film, that was that idea came about because I was having a show in London with some of my still photographs from my series called The Big Valley. And everyone that was coming up to me responding to the work was asking me what had happened just before or just after in the photograph. And so the first film that I did was a 3-minute kind of a look at what was happening just before and after in the picture. And so that was from the audience. I'm not saying that I need approval from the audience. I just want to know that it's being seen, and there might be some sort of connection, or that the audience has their own, brings their own story to it, or emotions, or history to it.
Remind me, do you? I know you do a lot of editorial work. Do you do advertising commissions as well?
I mean, you say a lot of editorial, but I don't really do that much.
Okay.
I've done maybe three ad jobs, and I worked for the New York Times a lot because they, I mean, they approach everything with me, or like I think with most of the photographers they work with, they have a lot of respect for photographers and leave the creative, like a lot of the creative freedom.
Do they propose a storyline or a topic to you, or do they come to you and say, have you got an idea for us?
It goes both ways. Like with the films for the Touch of Evil series, we knew it was going to be villains. I knew that when I took the job, and I knew I was going to be shooting certain celebrities. But from there, I got to just kind of go nuts with, well, what kind of villain are we shooting? Is it a villain that already existed, or are we imagining a villain? Or it was a really fun project.
But
Cody, I think you're touching on something that's very interesting. A possible generational.
Just 1 minute. Do you want to be accessing the slides, even if you have to scroll through them, if you just use the clicker?
Yeah, I may do that.
Okay,
I may.
Sorry.
Yeah, go on. I'm sorry.
That there may be a generational difference, that in a way that's self-selecting. That if for those of us who grew up in a time when there was essentially no audience, it wasn't part of the equation. And as the audience grew, then the artists entering into it that had to deal with that as a factor in the creative process.
Okay. Another question that Alex is interested in that we might broach a bit, because it came up this morning in an interesting way, was of course the difference between the culture of photography in New York and the culture of photography out here. New York had a budding culture of photography, LA perhaps less so in terms of an audience and museum interest and so forth back in the 60s and 70s. Do you feel now that there's a difference between the New York culture of photography, or the New York audience for photography, and the one that's out here? Any of you?
I'll take it.
Well, I thought that was an interesting question because I grew up here, and I've worked, you know, I didn't go to the art colleges, and Los Angeles just has a bit of a kind of a less structured feel to it to me, and the history with the art world, I feel like, isn't nearly as long, it isn't as deep, it's not as structured. So in a way, I kind of feel like Los Angeles still has a bit of a Wild West feel to it, in that artists can, they can get a big space here, live a decent lifestyle. We have nice weather, and you can really spread out here and kind of get really lost in your work. Mm-hmm. I think without being constantly up against what other artists are doing, what art, you know, we do have a strong art scene happening right now, and I think there's a lot of attention on LA, but it's also very easy to disappear here if you want.
What about you, Stephen? I mean, your view is still primarily from New York, from the East Coast. Do you feel that the scene out here is very different, or do you feel?
I don't think I have the background to mm-hmm. say.
To talk about that? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
I can't speak really to the present, but I, historically, and this sort of interfaces with the panel this morning. Mm-hmm. New York had a kind of continuity of photo galleries and had continuity of museums with photography departments.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Whereas out here we did not.
Right.
And really the discourse, the dialogue of people working as artists in the 70s and 80s was primarily through educational institutions. It was, you know, people from UCLA or CalArts or USC in dialogue with one another in that context as opposed to the context of the galleries. Mm-hmm. In a sense. And even when I would, where Stephen teaches at Bard for a few years, I would go and teach in the summer while I was still at CalArts, and they have a graduate program. And at CalArts, they didn't have, for example, a painter on the whole faculty. And then I would go to Bard, and the trajectory of abstract painting never broke. I mean, they still mm-hmm. had mm-hmm. these abstract mm-hmm. painters. In the same way with photography, there was kind of a continuity of a more isolated discourse there that was unbroken, mm-hmm. whereas here was completely fragmented and didn't exist in mm-hmm. that kind of way. Mm-hmm. And I think that had a big influence on practitioners in these two locations.
What, can you elaborate a little bit more on that and talk about specifically about your own work or about, you know, some of your colleagues from then, how, you know, how that was true? In, you know, in what ways?
Well, I mean, you know, we didn't have the kind of discourse, even though I personally actually made street photography for a while very early in my career. I mean, we didn't have like the kind of street photographers that sort of just continued in New York kind of unabated. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have, you know, we just didn't have the more conventional kind of photographic practice here as a primary mm-hmm. Sort of activity. Things were slopped over in terms of medium demarcations. Mm-hmm. You know, in my own case, I'm sort of, you know, doing something that's some kind of cross between performance and describing things sculpturally and painting. Like I'm trying to de-skill painting in a way. And it just seems kind of obviously different mm-hmm. in terms of that.
Well, part of the difference that you're talking about, especially in the early street photography things when you would find people watering their lawns or whatever, is that LA simply, I mean, it had a downtown area, but it didn't have the kind of density and the kind of contrast of dense people on the street that New York had, and didn't lend itself to that. And indeed, that your career very quickly evolved into an extremely solitary format. Of places that were not overcrowded but deserted or being pushed off of.
You know, I don't know. It's like, you know, I used to see Gary Winogrand walking up and down the Venice boardwalk taking street photographs, so he didn't seem to have any problem with the concept of coming here and doing it. So, I think it's something more than simply that the landscape mm-hmm. and doesn't lend itself to it. I think it's more the histories.
Okay, fair enough. Maybe we've got 15 or 20 minutes left. Maybe we should open it up to the audience. We'll do that, see if there, I see some hands going up as we say that, so.
Just a comment about the New York LA, and then it might engender a response. I think there's also another really important dimension about New York. It's the center of publishing, and way beyond Aperture, the ease of getting work documented into the book format means that it's accessible both to a broader audience that might or might not have gotten to the show. It's accessible to curators, That's, I think, a good deal of the reason of the importance of Pacific Standard Time, mm-hmm. which included not only the research about what was happening here in LA over that period, but all the publications. So I think for all sorts of reasons, whether it's photography, particularly any sort of, whether it's a medium that was slightly marginalized, or you know, individuals or groups that were marginalized during this time, it makes a huge difference. And the way that we now have broad publishing, it changes the landscape probably in New York and here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's someone who did a Pacific Standard Time show. I can certainly say that there was a kind of collegiality and a kind of connection both with individuals out here and within other institutions besides the one that I was in and from which I was doing my show, that really did create a kind of community and a communication among people who were sometimes geographically much further apart than people ever are in New York or on the East Coast generally, that was really terrific, and that that came together very easily, I felt, with the stimulus of the money that was available so that we could all do shows at the same time. But that didn't seem to exist naturally, again, partly just because of the diversity of the area and the fact that you didn't run into colleagues the way that when I lived in New York, where I lived for 20 years, I often did. It was just a different, the geography really made a lot of difference, I felt, in that way. Anyone else have a question? Anne's got her hand up. Can we? Let Anne go, and then we'll pick up this question over here.
There, in the 70s, there were a lot of action groups, like Harry was, like Aviso, and they were in New York and in Washington especially. Were you aware of those groups, and were you responding, the kind of everything from the Guerrilla Girls to... Mm-hmm. There was a collective of black artists in Washington who were also going to museums and doing actions. Were you aware of those groups on the East Coast?
You're talking to Harry, right?
Yeah
right.
There was no direct communication at that time, and I was not aware of them. I don't think they were aware of us. And there was also groups in Mexico City, No Grupo, and other organizations throughout Latin America, and we kind of all were responding. I think the connecting point actually was television to some degree, and that it was so dominant a force in terms of the kind of imagery that was being disseminated, and the focus of people that would receive attention were those, again, that were sort of... that were allowed to be on television at that point in time. And I was from a group of people that definitely were not, so. Mm-hmm.
Okay. There was another question down here somewhere.
There's one over there, to the left.
I'm interested in the difference between LA and New York photography, how it looks. It's obvious that it's part of the environment. It looks different here than it does in New York. But were you, especially the three longtime artists, were you like really conscious that you wanted to say something about this world, not all those people who think they know everything about art over there? Did you have a sense of that, or were you just thinking, this is what I'm looking at, this is what I'm interested in, I'm just gonna, look here?
For me, it's the latter.
Same for me.
Yeah, I wasn't looking to make, to inform anybody of anything or to set anybody straight. And they say in photography, content's automatic, sort of where you are and when you are is just completely integrated into what you do, so. And this is where I was, and that was when I was, and I am who I am, and that's what came out.
Wait,
Yeah. I'm on. One of the things that, in terms of this connection between Los Angeles and New York that needs to be brought up is the existence and the development of the Society for Photographic Education and the kind of networks that were established in 1964 between the Midwest and the East Coast and the West Coast here. So, you know, not to acknowledge the, that particular group of people and the kind of exchanges that happened when Nathan Lyons would come over to LA, or when Peter Bunnell would visit the West Coast, or when people from the Midwest would come over here, when Eileen Cowan was coming here. All these different kinds of practitioners, there was an ongoing discussion among groups of people. And I think, Anne, you can also address that. Very
I have a question. It's a very basic one, but since you all photograph in LA, what is it about the city that inspires you? If, even if it's something as basic as the light, the color, what is it about LA that is interesting to you?
I think you can walk outside today and see.
The one thing I would, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I wasn't.
I've talked too much. Go.
You go on.
No, me? Oh, okay. I've already forgotten what I was going to say. you know, the thing that's interesting about Los Angeles, other than the light's beautiful and the weather's incredible, so it's great for a photographer in that sense, is that it's an extremely dynamic place, that it's that it changes all the time. There's not a lot of you know, the city is, for the most part, most of it is not designed by unlike the Getty famous architects whose sensibility is kind of frozen into place. It's a place where somebody builds a taco stand next to a chiropractor, next to, you know, with non-indigenous trees planted in. And so the range of variation, you know, I think it was Edison said that, you know, what do you need to be an inventor? You need an imagination and a good pile of junk. And and it's not that it's a pile of junk, but it has these attributes of variation that make a lot of things possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also that carries over to the social realm, where everyone in the world comes here, and you step out the door and onto the street, and you hear 100 different languages, and some are from all the various continents, and some are the languages that were spoken here 2,000 years ago, all at once. And it's such a widespread area, you can go out every day and never bump into the same people twice. Mm-hmm. And so it really is a whole new cast of characters, and then the landscape changes, and you know, and this is a city where the pollution is rendered transparent, and it's still one of the most polluted places in the whole country. So it looks like a beautiful day, but it really isn't.
That's actually part of, like, what I see in Los Angeles, or what I'm inspired in Los Angeles, is the landscape is so beautiful, and we've got the chirping birds and the perfect, still, never-changing weather all the time. But yet, an earthquake could happen at any moment, or the wildfires could be blown out of control by the Santa Ana winds, or, you know, there's this weird underbelly where you feel like something is lurking just beneath the surface, that at any moment it could be violent or dangerous or like fucked up in some way. Just there's something weird about this city. It's just it has this promise of perfection and beauty and image, and it's very image obsessed and just constantly showing you this kind of bubble of perfection and glamour, and yet it's just it's much seedier than that, I think.
Yeah, well, this is how, to a large extent, film noir got created here, was that life looks so beautiful, and yet.
Yeah, exactly.
Stephen Les, you came back here in the mid-2000s, and again, photographed, it looks like, fairly extensively. Did you go to other places that you'd been to on your cross-country
journey? No.
Why did you come here?
For all the car culture, there's a lot of character in the architecture, which I think is what John is alluding to. Mm-hmm. That it just is, there's a genuineness. And because there's so many buildings that are one story, there's, it's not just that the light is nice light, that there is light. Uh-huh. That there aren't buildings blocking the light. Uh-huh. And I happen to like bright sunlight for my work. Mm-hmm.
Do you have trouble shooting around where you live? Because when I was at Bard, I couldn't take photographs. There were just trees everywhere.
Yeah.
Like, you know, here there's a horizon. You know, there is just damn trees are just.
Yeah, I mean, I did in the 80s. I did a series of pictures in the Hudson Valley, and it was one of the hardest things I'd ever done. Yeah.
I must confess that your pictures, the more recent ones, look to me, as I said when I was doing the introductions, the differences are subtle, but they do seem to me to be made almost literally on a different bias from the earlier ones. In fact, I put some together from earlier. The one on Coronado Street of this looks like it was a two flat built into a single but you tended to photograph that things either at right angles or head on. Mm-hmm. And in the more recent things, even when there's not a person there or some linchpin in the middle of the picture, you're shooting more at a bias, and it seems to me you're also shooting closer in. Mm-hmm. You're blocking up the frame much more than you did before. Is that a reaction to the city? Do you have a different feeling about it now? Do you have a different way of working now, wherever you are?
It wasn't specifically a reaction to the city, but it was a reaction. It was a reaction to, first, I would say, some visual issues I was interested in, but also, you always are dealing with what's in front of you. And so I wasn't thinking about the city, but I was thinking about this specific place that I'm standing in front of and how to make sense of it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm interested in observing visual convention in other people and in myself.
Mm-hmm.
And when I see it, that I'm imposing a strategy, I question it. And so that bias that you described, that lack of frontality, came from just realizing that this was an approach I had used a lot and that this was something I would that may actually be a filter between the experience and the picture.
Mm. Okay. But Harry, what about you? I know you've been doing pieces in Europe and you've been getting a lot of attention in Europe. Are you still working as hard here? And are the conditions different? Is the tenor, the mood, the atmosphere different for you?
Well, in Europe, I find myself, I was actually in Brussels the day they won the Nobel Peace Prize. And after 1,000 years of fighting each other, they got tired, I guess. But in LA, I find that the situation here is very interesting, very dynamic. But many of the kind of issues that might be pertinent to one group are never expressed to the other group. So, for instance, some of the people that I know are very concerned with immigration policy, and other people never even hear about it. But I know families, going to school, they get deported, have families disappear. The current president has nearly deported 2 million people, and they all happen to look like my grandchildren. So it takes a different perspective to make work that will reach other people so that it kind of has a cross-cultural sense of interest and poignancy, nonetheless, without having to drag people into political fights, which I guess I grew up in an era where it was at the Osco group, for instance. Many of our more well-known photographs were taken where there were violent confrontations that took place there.
Yeah,
and now it's which corner should I pick? Mm-hmm. It's, you know, there's been so many things that have happened in LA that they all have some kind of historical relevance, but the idea is to make people understand that we're kind of all here together and that it's really quite possible to share in a in an ongoing mirage that we might have fun nonetheless.
Yeah. Some of the problems like deportation are more diffused throughout the society. They aren't the flashpoints that there
right.
were before.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We've got a few minutes left. Are there any more questions?
I'm just curious, because the other thing that I remember from the 70s and the 80s was the introduction of Japanese photography and Latin photography and European photography that was beginning to come in at least. I mean, I remember the day Nathan Lyons called us all up to look at Killed by Roses and us all going, what the hell is that, you know?
Right.
And you know, besides Manuel Álvarez Bravo, then Pedro Mayer and Graciela Iturbide and other people are beginning to get their work shown in the U.S. And then, of course, after New Topographics, you got Bescher, and then you begin to get Bescher's students. You begin to get Ruth and Struth and other Germans. And I'm just wondering, because it seems like a little bit, I mean, I know the symposium is L.A., but we haven't really talked about a broader community that was really, at least in reviews in the magazines and in some shows, is beginning to be discussed. And I'm just wondering if any of that filtered into the work of the panelists.
Well, I would say that I don't think it filtered into my work exactly. But I was aware of a lot of this. I was a friend of Hilla Bescher since maybe 73 we first met. The gallery I was showing at had a huge, huge variety of approaches to photography, and some of the people mentioned in your panel today, Heineken, Robert Fichter, Keith Smith were shown with Emmett Gowan and Winogrand and Friedlander and Frederick Sommer and Paul Strand. It was just this huge range. And Hosoi was shown. And so I would say I was aware of it. Of all the people, the one that I think personally I thought about most in relation to my work may have been the Beschers.
Okay.
I'd like to ask each of the panelists to name a photographer that has really influenced them and their work, some other photographer.
The question was, you'd like people to mention someone who really influenced them in their work. Anybody want to?
Well, Walker Evans, everybody talks about Lee Friedlander. You know, I saw that book, Self Portrait, and I thought, nah, I'm going to give up. And then I got
that was the influence on you.
Well, I was like, damn, it's like, you know, just the way I had never even thought of photographs, you know. And I just,
yeah.
You know.
I would say coming out to LA and studying with Jim Willing really helped me sort of get messy with photography and have room for the, you know, he gave me a lot of recipes on how to develop a silver negative with coffee and just really, like, really interesting material approach and looking at photography.
Now again, was it there? It's both his influence and his openness to you as a teacher, but also his work.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. How you know? Again, I don't want to put you on the spot, but in what can you talk a little bit about the way in which his work, whether he was, you know, in the classroom, he wasn't talking about his work; he was talking about yours, presumably, or trying to talk in general terms. But you're looking at the work, and in what way was
I think it really, like, just talk about, like, the Lakes and Reservoirs project. It seemed that I didn't really know a lot about color and took color photography for granted and didn't know about the different layers and took it for granted for what a color photograph is, the chromogenic printing, the different layers. And I think, I don't know, maybe looking at your hexagraphs or something or the different filters and learning about the material that is photography.
Mm-hmm.
And also, you know, you say it's interesting too because I'm working in the darkroom, but then Jim's also working in the darkroom, and we're kind of waiting for the color processor together and we kind of chit-chat and show each other stuff. And there's something very nice about that, I feel like. Sorry to put you on the spot, Jim. But, but I mean, so there was something, you know, also working and being around, but, you know, the little discussions too, that looks good, you know, and I'm like, oh, I messed up the aperture on that one. You know, but Jim would like it and say, oh, maybe it is good. And sort of certain things like that that happen.
Okay.
Embracing accidents and trying to keep it open. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because before, I mean, back to the discussion of New York, I lived in New York a while, and I was making really tiny prints, you know. And then I come to LA, and it was just like direct-to-print digital stuff. And then coming back to LA, I had space and got messy with it, and had the dark room to really sort of study the material, I guess.
Okay. Say two, okay?
Yeah, everyone, we're going to take a 15-minute break so you can get up and enjoy the quality of light in Los Angeles and come back.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.